The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everyone. My name is Krista Brown. I'm training specialist with the APS Technical Assistance Resource Center, APS TARC, and I want to welcome you to our webinar, Using Change Management Principles and Operational Plan Implementation, with Michael Bischoff and Karl. Urban, and I will be introducing them in just a moment. Next slide. But before we get started, I'd like to share a little bit of information. This webinar is being hosted by the APS TARC, which is a project of the U.S. Administration for Community Living, Administration on Aging, Department of Health and Human Services, and administered by WRMA Incorporated. Any contractor findings, conclusions, and points of view do not necessarily represent the official policy of the federal government. Next slide. As many of you know, the APS TARC works with states and territories to enhance the effectiveness of APS programs by working with partners on use of data and analytics, applying research and evaluation to practice, and encouraging the use of innovative practices and strategies. We're here to help in any way we can, so just reach out to us using the contact information that you will see at the end of the presentation. Next slide. So, quick housekeeping. A handout of today's slides is available for download in the handout section of your webinar control panel, and you can download that at any time. You have control of your speaker volume and will be using your computer speaker, so go ahead and adjust it to your desired volume. If you experience any audio problems due to broadband or hardware issues, we recommend that you sign out and log back in. It is being recorded if something goes very astray, so don't worry. We'll have that recording for you. Next slide. We are planning on having time at the end of the presentation for Q&A and comments, but you can ask questions at any time of our presenters. Just use the questions box in your webinar control panel, and we may even ask you a few questions. And the presentation is being recorded, like I said, and we'll post it to the TARC website and let you all know when it's ready and posted with the slides. And then lastly, everyone attending will receive an email in about 24 hours with a link to download your certificate of attendance. Next slide. So before I introduce our presenters, we have a quick question for you. So using your questions box, could you answer what barrier or barriers could derail the success of your operational plan or project? So what barrier or barriers could derail the success of your operational plan or project? So go ahead and type that in, and I'm going to go ahead and do some introductions really quick. Okay, next slide. All right, it's my great pleasure to introduce my esteemed colleagues. Michael Bischoff is a strategic planning subject matter expert with the APS TARC, WRMA, and as many of you already know, Mike has been heavily involved with the development of operational plan tools and offering hands-on strategic planning and operational plan technical assistance to states and territories, so we're really happy to have him. And then Karl Urban, who really needs no introduction, I am sure, is Senior Research Manager with the APS TARC and is the team lead for the NAMERS system and leads and supports the TARC and in TA and evaluation projects. And Karl has been very busy lately. So I'm going to go ahead and hand it on over to Karl to get started. So next slide. And check out what your responses were.
All right, so good afternoon, everybody. So we basically have a presentation that's kind of divided into two parts. I'm gonna do the first half and Michael's gonna do the second half. Basically wanna talk about four ideas that you see listed here. I'm gonna focus on kind of the planning and getting started and the critical engagement that you need to do with partners, and then Michael's going to pick up and talk about sustaining and reflecting on change. So it's a little bit of how to do it and then how to make sure you're continuing to do it right and knowing if you are successful. Need to say right up front, We have lots of slides, lots of content, and we don't really plan to go over all of the bullet points on all of the slides. That content is there for reference. If you go back and listen to the webinar, if you want to look at the slides themselves, which I think, Krista, are in the panel thing over there. We have question and answer planned at the end. We will try to prompt and remind you to ask questions along the way. So that's the way things are going to work today. First thing I want to talk about, next slide, is how to think in systems to make organizational change possible. And the question is, how are you going to plan for change? What do you need to think about? And so I'm going to talk about this from a systems thinking framework. I apologize to those of you that have heard me talk about some of this before, but I think it is very applicable in this particular context. I'm going to reframe some of it for what I think you're trying to do with implementing the change that you are implementing. There's nothing magic about systems thinking. There are other frameworks in which to think about it. It's not better thinking. It's just a different way of thinking about things. And really the key is not the framework per se, but the questions that the framework provides that you need to consider. So along the way, you know, I'm going to be generating some key questions that you need to think about as we go through this. So next slide. The first point is really a very simple point. You've got to think about your people, your process, and your structures if you're going to successfully make change. So I am not going to talk much about people directly. You should not make that mistake. Morale matters a lot in being successful. But what's also true is what is on this next slide, which is that systems matter. And as this quote says here, when placed in the same system, people, however different, tend to produce the similar results. The system matters. And so I want to help you think through how you think about the system that you are operating in and how it influences the people, how it influences the behavior of the people within your system. So next slide. When we talk about a system, what are we talking about? This slide has a definition and lists out some of the key elements. The important thing about a system is it produces behavior based on the way it is organized and the way it is governed. It produces the same behavior over time. And so there's three aspects of a system or three things that you need to think about. The first one is, what's the function? What are you trying to accomplish? The second aspect is the elements. Who are the actors in the system? What are the variables in the system? And the third thing is the feedback loops or the interconnections among these variables and actors. How do people communicate with each other? How do the variables interact? When does that interaction become some sort of self-reinforcing behavior? All of these things add up to understanding the structure of your system. The key idea here is that structure drives behavior. Next slide. So we want to think in systems because it helps us to understand certain things. It helps to make patterns clear us, helps to make patterns clearer, and it helps us to see how to change things more effectively. We tend to focus on snapshots. We tend to focus on isolated parts of the system. We see what is in front of us. We don't necessarily expand our vision to look at the whole system of what is going on. You got to look at the whole system if you really want to solve your deeper problems. And so we look at systems for all of the reasons that you see here, because we want to figure out how to address behavior. We want to address side effects. We want to get underneath to the beyond just the tip of the iceberg. We don't want to be in the process of blaming people. We want to understand the system that's causing the behavior, and we've got to identify the aspects of the structure that are causing the behavior if we want to change it. Next slide. So There are six critical systems thinking concepts here, and I want to talk about each of these briefly, a couple of them in a little bit more detail than the other ones. So the first idea in the next slide is that structure drives behavior. Systemic structure is concerned with the key interrelationships that that influence behavior over time. These are not necessarily the relationships between people, but the relationships among the key variables in your system. Behavior results from motivation. Motivation is caused by the structure. And so when we're talking about structure, what we're talking about is the process, the interrelationships, and the cultural framework in which we are working. Since we're all bureaucrats, I think for the most part, we probably have a pretty good handle on policy and practice, and maybe a little less so on culture. So I want to talk specifically about culture for a second. I even think ACL has an upcoming webinar on policy that looks pretty good. So next slide, thinking about culture, what do we mean when we talk about organizational culture? Well, you can see all of the words that are in bold here that kind of come from this standard business definition: expectations, experiences, philosophy, values, image, workings, interactions, attitudes, beliefs, customs, rules. Bottom line is culture is how things work. What is the grease on the wheels of how an organization, particularly how a system functions? So when we think about culture on the next slide, you've got to make culture your, you got to understand, is culture helping you or hurting you? Is it your friend or is it your enemy in the change that you are trying to implement? What we can't do is we can't ignore it. And the two quotes you see here kind of explain why. It doesn't matter how good your strategy is in your operating plan, if you haven't figured out how culture is either enabling or constraining you, it will eat up your strategy. You got to figure out how to deal with culture in order to make your strategy successful. And so as that bottom thing says, you got to identify your strengths and weaknesses of the culture and then make sure your strategies are consistent with that. And you want to think about it in terms of communication, leadership, stakeholders, and creating momentum and measuring progress. And we're going to talk about all of those things as we go. So next slide. So the second big idea we wanted to talk about is that cause and effect always exist. And as we talk about some of these other principles, just kind of want to plant some questions that you need to be thinking about as you're implementing your operating plan. And so within this concept of cause and effect always exist, you know, we intuitively know this, but what we may intuitively know doesn't mean that we necessarily go the next step and ask ourselves these questions. So you need to ask yourself the question, what are the root causes? What's going on below the surface of that iceberg that may be causing something to happen? And then the other thing that you've always got to think about, you've always got to anticipate, is what are the unintended consequences of the change that you are trying to make? You may not be able to think those through in advance, but you should sure try to do so. The next systems thinking concept is the concept of leverage. And this is kind of the beauty of systems thinking, is it helps you to figure out where you need to focus your efforts to make change. And to do that, you have to think about what interventions are going to have the biggest impact and how you can make that particular intervention. And to do that, you've got to think about all of those elements of structure that we were talking about a minute ago. What are the purpose? What are the feedback loops? What are the variables? What's the culture of the situation in which you are trying to change? And then you got to ask yourself, which of these can you actually change or clarify? In particular, you want to think about your feedback loops. You need to figure out which ones are easier to change and which ones are going to have the biggest impact. Next slide. And so that's important to do because some of those things are going to be constraining you. Some of those things are going to be enabling you. You need to know which ones are which. You want to reinforce the ones that are enabling you. You want to change the ones that are constraining you. And the ones that are harmful, is you're getting rid of those is probably your best leverage point that you have for making change. The good news is that when you've identified a leverage point, you're not talking about making a huge world earth-shattering change. You can often make a very focused, targeted change, and that's going to result in the change that you need. But to do that, you got to figure out where that leverage point is for you. We have a tendency to focus on the symptoms instead of the problem. Again, intuitively, you know this. So here's two questions you need to be asking yourself. Why does this problem keep recurring despite repeated attempts to solve it? And are we actually getting at the root cause? Short-term versus long-term. On the next slide, you need to be both short-sighted and long-sighted. You need to identify short-term pressures felt by key people, but then you also need to be thinking about long-term consequences and deciding how to address a problem. Next slide, principle of eroding goals. This is something you're going to have to deal with. Maybe your goals weren't appropriate at first, or maybe they need to change. Reality is that in most project goals erode. And so you need to be cognizant of that, and you need to be thinking about the long-term consequences of that if it is in fact going to be happening. So that's kind of the framework from a systems thinking perspective. And now I want to talk about, okay, given all of that, what are the steps that we can engage in to make sure our partners are helping us to make the change that we want to make? So next slide. The question is, how do we engage those partners? We want to get the climate favorable for change, but then we have to engage the partners. So some things to think about, and I'm just going to run through a list of these very quickly. So first one, identify key partners and develop a plan to engage them. Again, fairly obvious kind of thing to do, but the key to this one is what's in the purple at the bottom. You need to not just have a mental assent to or spend a couple of minutes thinking about who are my partners. You should proactively get a pencil and paper out and write down the answers to these questions. You can find online very easily some planning tools for how to engage your partners, things you need to think about. If you can't find them, we've got some, I think we've done in some previous workshops. Do it. Just do this because it's really important for you to put the effort in up front to think about who your stakeholders are and how to engage them. Second thing, next slide, is that once you know who your stakeholders are, you need to be able to communicate a change vision to them. You need to think about how you're going to make a change in your culture and using that culture to your advantage. You know, the saying is it is hard to over communicate, and in most change type activities that are complicated, you cannot over communicate. And so you want to have different mechanisms for communication. And as it says there, do it over and over and over again. Next slide. You have to be inclusive. You have your list of stakeholders, so you want to make sure everyone has a voice and everyone is aligned and marching in the same direction that you are going. You want to be aligned with your stakeholders to the maximum extent possible. You want to listen to them. You want to consider their perspectives. You want to communicate with them. And it may be possible that somebody is just never going to align. So as it says here, you kill them only if necessary. And so what we mean by that is you may just have to minimize their influence on the process. Otherwise, you want everybody as aligned as possible. And if somebody is not aligned, then you need to figure out how you're going to do with them. If you don't focus on inclusion, the literature tells us that's one of the core reasons that transformation efforts often fail. So next slide. You got to have champions. You can communicate, you can be in alignment, but you got to have somebody out there that is reinforcing your vision, even if they don't completely agree with your method. You got to have that reinforcement from the key people within your system that operate at those key leverage points. You got to have champions if you're going to be able to be successful. So you want to identify and inculcate them into your vision, into your understanding of the culture, and you want to inform and inspire those champions to take up your cause. So within the world of APS, particularly when you're thinking about leverage points, the supervisor is your most important ally. If you don't have your APS supervisors on board, you will not be successful in your change effort. They are your key point of leverage in the APS system. So you either need to make the supervisors your champions, or you need to have your champions focused on making sure that the supervisors are in alignment with what you are trying to do. Fifth, next slide. You want to empower others. You want to allocate responsibility, ownership, accountability, empowerment. They're all management cliches, and they're all cliches because they are all true. And if you're going to be successful, that's what you have to do as you do this. You cannot do it all yourself. So the questions that you need to ask yourself to empower, create ownership and accountability are the questions that you see listed here. Next thing, and this is kind of going back full circle, you need to align your systems and your structures. You have to change structure if you're going to make change and if you're going to succeed. So think about those things related to structure that we talked about in the beginning of this. You're going to have to change policy and practice as you need it. That's sort of your foundation. You're going to have to provide the right amount of training on the right things to the right people within a change management kind of situation. That is your critical investment. Be thinking about how you're going to do training and make sure it aligns with your systems within your structure that you're trying to change. Then you need to manage fear and fatigue while instilling discipline and resiliency, all of that within the context of the culture. You've got to understand the culture. Who is fearful? Who is tired? How do we get them on board? How do we ensure that they're disciplined and that there's resiliency in the system as we move forward to make the change? As I've said before, if you don't change the structure, you are not going to be successful. Finally, you want to use your leverage points and create positive feedback loops. So this is what we talked about earlier. You do all this stuff, and then you're able to target on those points within the system where you can create changes in the structure that will result in positive feedback loops so that you can make change. I list here some of the ways to think about doing that in terms of communication, leadership development, words and rewards and recognitions. You know, there are hard ways to do things and there are easy ways to do things, and targeting those leverage points is the easy way to make change. So that was really quick kind of run through on some ideas on how to get started making change. Now, Michael's going to talk a little bit about how to pick up on that and how to do the follow through and the assessment on that part of that. knowing that I ran through this pretty quickly, if you've got any questions, please put them in the question box while Michael is talking, and I will turn it over to Michael.
All right, thank you, Karl, for that systems thinking framework. That's great. I'm going to be a little bit less theoretical, a little less big idea, maybe a little bit more prescriptive and tool oriented in these last few slides. If I can have the next slide here. So implementation is where a lot of otherwise well-crafted plans fall short if you don't have the systems in place to sustain them. So you go through the hard work of identifying the change, accepting it, building plans to how are you going to address it. But if you let off the gas once you have your plan in place, you can have a lot of difficulty that way. We have this kind of sobering quote here from Professor Johnson, but it's really not to say that half of all change efforts fail completely, but that a number of change efforts fail to completely achieve all that they set out to achieve. So it's really important to keep the pressure on to maintain the focus. Next slide, please. So if I could give you really just kind of two things to think about for implementation, it would be one, to assign individual responsibility for each project and to track the progress on a regular, routine, ongoing basis. So when I talk about individual responsibility, this doesn't mean one person is going to do all the work, but one person is going to be responsible for tracking it, being able to say at any point in time how it's going, where it's at, what's needed, and really focus on the four W's. So with each project, who will do what, by when, and with what resources. And you remember Lauren, who worked with Jennifer and I on a lot of the planning meetings, wrote a white paper where she said, people are a lot more likely to do what you inspect than what you expect. I think this is really true. To make this work, you have to have a regular inspection or an ongoing tracking process. And the way to do that probably is to have regular review meetings to help keep the desired changes on track. Just like you wouldn't build a budget and then never revisit again, you can't build a plan, a change plan, an operational plan, and not revisit it. So tools like having quarterly manager reviews, dashboards, project tractors, collaborative workspaces like we had in Huddle can all help. And it's great if you can have high-tech interactive dashboards, real-time data created by your IT department. But if that's not in the budget, you can accomplish a lot just by regular monitoring with simple spreadsheets and tables a process to review them systematically. So we look at the next slide. This is something you've probably seen before in some of our meetings. This is just a simple spreadsheet. I think we call it the strategy communicator, strategy tracker. But you could take this into each quarterly meeting just to review kind of what your vision is, what your high-level goals are, and the individual projects you have. And then within each project, there should be an assigned individual that can really talk about the key metrics, where you are. You may have stage gate type of measures. Say it's a communication plan, you may have development of the content by a certain time, hold your first town hall meeting by a certain time, cover 90% of the state by a different time. But to be able to talk about those and to be able to characterize a project as being kind of green, yellow, red, on track, just a quick update on it. If it's yellow or red, see what needs to be done, additional resources need to be applied to it or change of direction. So that's a simple tool that you can use. Next slide, please. So the other thing is that there's going to be risks. There's going to be changes that happen in the external environment. You know, like the t-shirt says, stuff happens. And your goals can, there's a lot of things that can affect your goals that happen in the external environment that you don't control. So don't be afraid to correct course along the way. Jack Welch, the former CEO of General Electric, used some colorful language sometimes, so I'm going to not use his exact language, but paraphrase a little bit and make it relate to your program. When the rate of change in the external environment exceeds the rate of change in your program, you're in trouble. So I think the external change we know is going to keep happening, and you'll need to keep making corrections and address risks that you face as you go. So it's a good idea to track risks regularly so you can respond quickly. Like this is a tool you probably have seen a few times, but just pick a handful, say a half a dozen risks, assign one person to look at each of them, And each of your quarterly meetings, look at these risks reviewed by likelihood, just low, medium, high, how likely they are to happen, how disruptive they would be if they would happen, what some early warning signs are, and then rate them. So something like economic slowdown, I think I actually created this chart for a presentation back in August, and economic slowdown wasn't much of a problem, but you had early warning signs like inflation, unemployment, consumer confidence, and we see a lot of potential for an economic slowdown here. And so you think about how will that affect the possibility of seniors facing abuse, neglect, or exploitation as we enter an economic slowdown. So continue to track those risks, change direction as you need to. Think of a sailboat. If you ever see a sailboat going across the lake, they don't usually sail in straight lines. They have to tack back and forth as the wind changes, but they're always driving to the same destination, the shore, the port. And so you may also have to tack back and forth a little bit to reach the safe harbor that you're headed for. Next slide, please. So the next section is to review and reflect on change. Next slide, please. So we're gonna review what you went through with the ARPA grant process. And just since you had a lot of information to go through here, we're gonna be a little more lighthearted here. Just for fun, we're gonna view it through the eyes of characters from the Wizard of Oz movie. And just like movies always have little disclaimers, I'll say the characters in this representation are fictional. Any resemblance to any ACL or APS TARC employee, current or past, living or dead, is purely coincidental. Next slide, please. So after the COVID grant, you found out there was going to be additional grants in this American Rescue Plan Act of 2021, and then the second one. So you got this news that your program was going to get lots of extra money, which was great. I love the expressiveness of Dorothy's face here. Finally, she already knows how she's going to spend that money. However, next slide. Then you found out you would have to do an operational plan. And look at that face. And some of us looked a little bit like this as we started in our planning meeting, missions and visions and SWOTs, oh my. You knew that you had a journey ahead of you, but you weren't sure exactly how you would get there. Next slide. What you found out was that you didn't have to do this journey down this road completely alone. There were other things like the webinars we had early on, templates, toolkits, collaborative workspaces, subject matter experts, both in APS topics and strategic planning topics. And so you had some things to help you along the road. And just like Dorothy wasn't terribly fond, say, of the lion when she first met him, some of you weren't real fond of SWOTs or logic models when you first met them. But as you went on, you found how these tools could help you. And then finally, now you're reaching the point, most of you are at or will soon reach the point where your plan's gonna be approved. So you've made it to the Emerald City. Next slide, please. So I think what we can learn from that reflection is that I wanna focus on the difference between working in versus working on your program. There was a book by Michael Gerber called The E-Myth, where he really talked about working in versus working on your business. So working in your program is doing all the urgent day-to-day things that have to be done. Working on your program is taking a step back to look at the big picture of how your program runs and making improvements. And with the ARPA grants, we had kind of the opportunity and the requirement to work on the program. And that's good because it's really easy to be drawn in and spend all the time working in your program. The phone rings, there's a lot of things you need to do. But as you become a supervisor and a leader, you have to have systems and processes to let you work on the business. And think about spending maybe up to 10% of your time working on the business rather than just in it. Next slide. So this is kind of a simple model. I'm gonna walk through each of the steps, but think of this as a feedback loop or a system to make change easier to navigate as you reflect, assess, set goals, make plans, and implement and monitor your progress. Next slide, please. So reflecting is the thinking about the past cycle you went through. A lot of times these are annual cycles. You might only do your plan every 2 years or something, but reflect on that cycle and think about what worked, what didn't work, what you can learn from it, what you can change next time. And then recommit to your mission and your values. Your mission basically isn't gonna change. You're gonna be protecting vulnerable adults from abuse, neglect, exploitation, your values are going to stay largely the same. You're going to champion safety and dignity, demonstrate respect for people. You're going to help adults make decisions, make their own decisions as long as they don't harm others. And so what's going to change from time to time is your vision of where you want to be in the future. So reflect what you learned and set your vision for the future. Then the next step, assess. You were through this really with your environmental assessment. I know a lot of you have done this for a long time. And you can feel like you've seen everything there is to see and know everything there is to know about adult protective services. But from time to time, the environment changes. So once a year, once a cycle, don't assume that you have a perfect knowledge of your environment because it's probably changed. You know, open the window and get your wide angle lens and take a picture of the environment. Get input from your partners, both inside and outside of your department and organization. You're going to know 90% of what they tell you, but it's that few new things they tell you that you didn't really know or didn't know how they felt that's going to make a lot of difference. So again, you have tools to do this like the SWOT and the PESTEL. The third step then is to set goals, new goals for the coming period. So they should flow out of your environmental assessment, be high level and relatively few in number. Next, please. So make plans, the more detailed plans. Each goal may have several projects that come out of them, and you have to create higher level plans for them. And as you create those projects, think about making them what we call SMART: specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and timely, having set timelines for their achievement. And a tool to use for that is the logic model. And finally, implement, like we just talked about, using tools like the the quarterly progress reviews, the strategy communicator. And then it's just an ongoing cycle. So you do it again. Like they say in marketing, lather, rinse, repeat. Next slide, please. So that sounds like kind of an abstract process. How do you do that? And a big part of it is just to calendarize it. Every year, if you know that you're gonna go through these steps at a certain time, it's a little easier to do. So it's probably not uncommon in your personal life to reflect as you get into December, January timeframe, and set resolutions for the new year. I would encourage you with your department, with your program, to not just have resolutions, but to build plans for what you want to do. So as the winter begins, as you come into February and March, go through that assessment process, repeat it each cycle. I'm looking here at an annual cycle. Like I say, yours might be every couple of years or something, but on this annual cycle, February, March, do the assessment. Just like when you sent your survey out to external stakeholders and they kind of were, what is this? If you do this each year, people are going to be used to it, comfortable with it. You'll probably get some more interesting feedback. Then as the winter starts to come to spring, set your goals based on what you learned in your assessment. In the late spring, make your plans and spend the rest of the year then implementing, monitoring, and improving the process. So don't make a resolution, make a plan. And next slide, please. So as you go through all this, how do you know when you're done? Next slide. It's kind of a trick question. You're never done. You're always just somewhere in the cycle. You're somewhere in the system. That's the nature of leadership. That's the extra thing you have to do beyond just the day-to-day work, is to step back from time to time and work on your business instead of in your business. So in the interest of time, I will turn it back over to Krista, and we'll answer some of your questions. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Mike and Karl. That was really a lot of information, very good information. And we did have a couple questions come in, and I have one as well. So Karl or Mike, I'll start with Karl. Is there an example of what an eroding goal would look like, kind of in the realm of the operational plan or project plan?
Go ahead, Michael.
You want to go first, Karl?
No, go ahead.
An example of a eroding goal is sometimes things change in the external environment that you can't control. So you may have had a goal in 2019 to really increase the number of times that you spend on site with clients and victims, and more face-to-face, more personal time. Then COVID hit, and it wasn't possible to spend as much time face to face. You had to do things differently. So that would be one case of how a goal can erode because of external changes. It has to erode, or it has to change a little bit in terms of how you're like the sailboat tacking, you know, from side to side. You're still trying to get to the same destination. The other way the goals can erode then, I think, is when you have changes within your organization internally, things you do control, rather you lose focus, other things start to overtake you. And so that's where having these meetings on a regular basis where you can start to identify as a goal starts to erode, you see it kind of moving from red to yellow, to from green to yellow to red. Karl, I'll maybe let you elaborate.
Well, both the internal and the external can cause goals to erode, and it may be you were not realistic in the beginning, that the goal was not appropriately set, and you have to adjust to what is actually achievable. The fact that goals erode, and maybe the word change is better, it certainly has a lot less negative connotation than the word erode. The fact that goals change is not necessarily a bad thing. I can't speak for ACL. I don't think, even from ACL's perspective, I think there's an understanding that goals change over time, and sometimes perhaps they're too ambitious, or sometimes they were inappropriately targeted. And as you start this process of engaging your stakeholders, and all of that, you may just learn that things change and you have to change with them.
Great. Thank you both for that. Because I saw when we asked about barriers, potential barriers for operational planning and projects, I did see that there were some concerns around inconsistent upper management support or buy-in at different levels. So I think that kind of that could be something around maybe goal change or goal realism. And then also one person, it's really around the structure of state level with county government level approvals and such. So I could see where that can create some goal change.
I think we're divided a lot, certainly we see it at a national level, where an election, if you're in a swing state, can change the direction, the funding that your department receives and the directives that you're being given from the legislature. So that there's a lot of things that can cause you to have to change your goals.
Good point. All right, so we do have another question. So if the supervisors are not on board, any recommendations on how to handle that if they're a really key part of this systems change?
So to link it back to the previous question, you're facing a situation of eroding goals if you do not have your supervisors on board. So not facetiously, you may need to change your goals, or you're going to have to figure out how to get them on board. I don't think you will be successful if you don't get them on board. It's just that simple. I am sure there are exceptions to that. But in my opinion, from my years of experience, they are your key leverage point within APS. You really need them on board. I'm not going to give you a way out of it. Sorry. I don't have an alternative for you.
I think that communication really is key. You know, your supervisors are smart people. That's why you made them supervisors. You need to understand why they're not on board. What it is, you know, I mean, at Summits, yeah, we're too busy for this change. But there's probably other kind of second level things. And so if you really can drill down and find out what their reason is and start to address their concerns. And you have to accept the fact they might be right. Maybe it's not possible to do it. But you can't answer that until you know their concerns.
Yeah, if you go back to that champion side, if they're not on board, this is your opportunity to do some very careful listening to make sure that you understand what is going on in your environment, particularly within the culture of your environment. It's an opportunity to listen. And then, as Michael says, you have to be able to communicate to address whatever the concern is. You might have to change your goals. You might figure out what the problem is, and you can make that key structural change that will get them on board.
And I guess the other part of the communication then is make sure that they understand your goals, where they came from, why you're doing. You know, nobody likes change. We accept change and we work with it. But a tool like that strategy communicator, the logic models, are a way for you to kind of go from here's a problem that exists that we're trying to solve, and here's the goals we've set, and here's the things that lead us to want to do this project. So, you know, as a leader, again, it's our responsibility to communicate to everybody in the field what we want to do and why. There was a former CEO of General Motors, Roger Smith, and he had some difficult times during his tenure, and he went back, he said, you know, I think the biggest problem I had was that I didn't communicate enough why I was making the changes I was making. We were tearing things up, we were putting in robotics, and nobody understood the reason why we wanted to do it. And so that he felt like that was his failure, failure to explain and address the logic behind the goals that were set so that they don't seem like they're just some random pronouncement coming down from on high.
Yeah, I was just this morning, I was looking at some of the survey data from the practice survey that we did about the roles of supervisors. They are in almost all programs across the country involved in almost all of the key decision-making things, whether we're going to seek a protective order, what the disposition is going to be, what types of services, signing off on the final case. Their role is just overarching in terms of the way that process works, not to mention the role that they have in terms of the morale and the training of the individual caseworker. So you've just got to have them on board. I thought Ellen in the question said it very well. She said, it takes a lot of listening and discussion with supervisors. And I think that is true.
Heck yeah, let's give our APS supervisors some love, shout out. So we do have another question. Do you think the APS TARC might consider offering help with implementing and tracking change like they did with developing the operational plan?
I don't know if that's an Andy question. From a SME perspective, that's what we're here to do, to assist you with. So if, you know, we can, just like we got on the phone with you during the operational planning phase, we can get on the phone with you, with Michael particularly, and we can walk through those tools, and we will be glad to help you with that. So that's a great question, Nancy.
And I don't know, Andy,
if you wanted to add anything to that or not.
Sure, and this is Andy Caper. I just happen to be on the line. Yeah, we can help with that. The short answer is yes. So talk to your TARC liaison or your SME right now. We have subject matter experts working with the states. We're going to be transitioning next month to some different folks here on staff, the TARC. So we would be happy to help you sort that out. Just let us know.
So as we're waiting for a couple more questions to roll in, so any special considerations? We just talked very, very briefly about a comment from a state-administered, county-run state, but any special words of wisdom for those programs in particular?
It changes the consideration of who's internal and external. You would like to think those county administered programs are internal, but the reality is that sometimes they are external. And while one is tempted to say it is more challenging in those types of environments because of governance structures are not uniform up and down the whole system. I think that's a little naive when you're talking about particularly big state-run systems. You may have one governance system, but you may have multiple cultures within a program. And so I don't think it's simple black and white that county-based structure is inherently more difficult. I think the answers to the questions are different, but I don't think the questions that you need to deal with are any different.
I think the importance of that communication, the why you're making the changes you're making, it becomes even more important because everybody hears it a little bit differently. And so the repetition and taking the time to explain, particularly to people that disagree or that don't understand why you're doing what you're doing. And then just, value their input. It's like having a fight with your spouse or significant other. You have to start with the assumption they might be right, you might be wrong. So hear them out.
All righty. So any other questions? This is your last chance at this point in time to have the ear of Karl and Mike. If not, we will go ahead and go to the next slide. All right. Well, I would like to thank Karl and Mike for their wisdom and all the information. You can, just a reminder, download those slides in the handout section of your control panel, and they will be also available when the recording is up on the website. Lots of good info in there. I'd also like to thank Andy Capehart and Jennifer Kirchen, who were part of the planning process for this webinar. And I want to thank you all for your great questions and for being here today. So we hope to see you for the next APS TARC webinar for the field, and that'll be on Promising Practices Spotlight, Focus Care Coordination, and Elder Advocates. We will have folks from Idaho and Maine talking about two of their ACL grant-funded programs. That's on April 26th from 3 to 4 Eastern. And contact us if you haven't seen any registration come through. It's been in a few different places, and we'll send a reminder out soon. So have a great rest of the day and the rest of your week. And here is how you can contact us and follow us. So thanks very much, everyone. Take care.